Posterization, also known as color quantization, is a quite uncommon filter that's mostly used in stylized rendering. I've been experimenting with this unique effect for over a year now, but I haven't managed to implement it into a game, until now. In simple terms, posterization is about taking in a value and then doing some simple calculations to limit the range of the output based on a parameter called steps. Let's quickly take a look at this example. Here we have this black to white gradient. After applying the posterization filter with 16 steps, you get this image as a result. The color range gets limited to a smaller range of 16 colors, so we get these nice bands of color. The step parameter doesn't necessarily set the number of colors on the end result though. This only happens for values between 0 and 1, while inputs outside that range will be snapped to the closest step. After seeing this example, the first thing you'd probably try is applying this effect to the RGB channels of the image. However, you might be surprised to see that this doesn't resemble the first image I showed earlier at all. We get a bunch of these really weird colors that weren't originally present on the input image, and a very high contrast that's probably not desired. These weird colors appear because each color channel gets offset a little bit by the filter, but when multiplied by the three color channels, this drastically changes the final color. This basic implementation could be very useful for some temporary effects, like getting hit, but I wouldn't use it all the time as a full screen effect. Let's see if we can take this further. The use of posterization isn't only limited to using it on RGB values, as I sort of teased that before. In fact, you can use it on any floating point value. Let's take a look at this other example. Here's a cylinder that I subdivided a bunch of times. I'm going to use a custom shader with a posterization function already implemented. In the vertex shader, let's offset the vertices on the z-axis using a sine wave to make it look wavy. As you'd probably expect, the result is very smooth, so let's change that with posterization. By taking the calculated offset and running it through the filter, we get this interesting looking choppy effect. By changing the step parameter, the range of valid positions increase, which makes the animation look faster. Neat! Now all of this is cool, but now you'll probably want to know how I achieve this cleaner posterization look for the game jam version of my game. From our previous tests, posterizing the RGB values of an image seemed to be a bad idea. However, there exists a color space that's more suitable for what we're trying to achieve. The HSV color space is something you definitely heard about if you're watching this video. While RGB takes in red, green and blue values to make a certain color, HSV takes in hue, saturation and value, also known as brightness. It's a very commonly used color space and I highly recommend using it as it's a lot more powerful than RGB. Converting from RGB to HSV sounds like a very complicated thing, but thankfully some people have already done the work for us, so we can just copy their solution instead. Using their function, we can split any color to hue, saturation and brightness channels. We can already do a bunch of fun things with this, like making a slider to control saturation for some accessibility settings in the future. But, of course, with any float value, we can posterize these as well. We're mainly interested in the brightness value, as modifying it will keep most of the original colors intact. Let's save this and try it out. Huh. You might be either very surprised, or you completely expected this result. The problem is quite obvious. Even though we are using the HSV color space to calculate our values, the screen is expecting to receive RGB values, but currently we are assigning hue to the red channel, saturation to green, and brightness to blue. To fix this, all we need to do is to convert our HSV color back to RGB and pass that to the output. This was surprisingly simple, and this is basically all I did for the jam version of my game. I made some improvements since then, which allowed me to generate and use color palettes in real time. Let's take a look at how I achieved that, as I think it's really cool. The base shader is still the same as before. However, we are going to be overriding the HSV values with a couple new functions. We're going to start off with 5 variables that control the art style. The base color, brightness, darkness, tint, and saturation. The goal is to mimic how pixel artists choose their color palette based on a starting color. The brighter the color, the more hue shift towards yellow and the less saturated it gets, while darker colors are more saturated and their hue shifts towards purple. As a preparation, we're going to convert the input color and the base color to HSV color space. For the first step, let's calculate the brightness, as it influences both the hue and saturation of the final color. I honestly can't really explain what's going on here, as most of it came down to experimenting with different functions to see what works the best. But essentially, the brightness parameter makes bright parts brighter, while the darkness parameter makes everything darker. We're going to use this calculated brightness to add extra tint and saturation to the output color based on its difference to the base color's brightness. This will get us more color and a nicer palette from an art standpoint. After the coloring is done, it's time to posterize the result. I'm using a different global variable for each channel to have a bit more color over how it looks. At the end, we need to convert back to RGB as always, and I passed the original alpha for transparency support. Offsetting the output brightness before calculating the tint and saturation with a scrolling noise texture can be used to break up the circles that this implementation is currently generating. Different noise patterns will look completely different, so take your time to experiment. This is very easy to do in Godot, because there's a built-in noise texture generator that's surprisingly powerful. Now that we're done with this part, there's still a bit more to add before we can call our shader finished. A quite obvious addition would be adding support for multiple palettes at the same time. This by itself doesn't sound that hard, but figuring out how to decide which parts of the screen are part of a different palette is going to be a bit tricky. The current best solution I found was assigning a separate render layer for objects that use a different color palette, and then rendering those objects into a separate texture using subviewports, which are basically the same as render textures in Unity. These textures are going to be transparent if a pixel doesn't hit a mesh, and so we can use that to determine which layer the current pixel is part of. In the shader, we're going to do the exact same palette calculations as with the main layer, but with a different parameters this time. At the end of the shader, we'll check if the current pixel hit anything on the second layer, and if it did, we will override the result with that layer's color. As you can see, we have a second layer now. I'm actually using another layer made specifically for the enemies only, but currently all of them are in work in progress, so I'll save them later for another video. I also added a layer where the filter gets completely bypassed, so I can make some complex effects later. So to summarize, posterization is a very cool effect that can be used in many ways, but for some reason it's incredibly underused. Using it on HSV channels can lead to generating some controlled bands of color in real time, which can turn into some very unique art styles that I haven't really seen before that much. If you enjoyed this video and want to support me, you know what to do. And also, please tell me in the comments if you know of any other games that use posterization for their art style. See ya!